Thumbs up to this guy. Woo! One way.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Tim. Let's hear it again for Tim Foley. What a great way to get this thing started off.
Wahoo!
So, great. Sarah, are you here? Can I hear you, Sarah?
I'm here, baby.
All right. We can't get started unless Sarah's here from California.
Sorry, I was late.
Sarah will teach everybody how to be an enthusiastic, unmuted person. All right. So thank you so much for doing this. Thank you to Barbara. Thanks to everyone at the UU. I'm so happy to be here, even virtually. I'm going to start out with a little song that I wrote because I have been married 42 years. Congratulate me, those of you that are not
Woo!
Muted. Go ahead.
Big deal.
This is a song that I wrote after my son went to college and my wife realized that there wasn't going to be any buffer between us anymore. It was a very difficult moment for Mrs. White, and she's so happy that I travel around the country. I used to travel around the country. Now I just stay at home and perform it for people in little squares. All right, here we go. It's Thursday night with Dawn White. We've been doing it for 3 months, and we're going to do it until people stop showing up. Rascal is a dog, he came in too bright. Me and Rascal were sitting on the couch last night. When my woman come in and she started to cry, she looked at us with such terror in her eyes. I've been raising these kids for 18 years. Now they're growing up and they're moving out of here. And my big reward for all that I've been through is this dog as dumb as mud. And you, yippee-yahoo. Rascal looked at me in disbelief, he said. She can't be talking about you and me. She has got us to spend the rest of her whole life with. Would you please tell her how incredibly lucky she is? And I said, who's gonna love you any better than this? We'll wake you up every morning with big wet kisses. When we hear the police sirens in your neighborhood, we throw our heads up in the air and we howl for you. It'll be a good night, I know it, and that's cool. You gotta admit that's pretty cool. Well, you know, I don't believe we had succeeded in convincing her of the outrageous good fortune that had befallen her. In fact, instead of looking happy as she could be, she looked a little bit, well, you know, suicidal to me. But hey, kids go to college, kids move away, but dogs and husbands, that's who stays. To you it seems like a big trick of fate, but me and Rascal don't see it that way. With me, cuddly, ain't we cute? We are both real funny and we're both real true. There's another thing about us that's very cool. If you scratch us on our belly, our left leg moves. And you gotta admit that's cool.
Ow. Ow.
Ow.
Ow.
Well, okay, so maybe we ain't that smart. We're a couple of mutts with a lot of heart. But no one could ever love you better or give you more loyalty than this dog as dumb as mud. Than this dog as dumb as mud. Than this dog as dumb as mud. And me, how lucky can one girl be? She got a dog like you and a man like me. We'll be together well into this next century. Put that knife down, baby. There we go, it's fun.
Yay.
Clap, clap, clap.
All right. I know a wife and a husband. They had a shiny little kid. When that kid turned 16, you won't believe what he did. He smoked a lot of marijuana. He did some other things too. Then he told his parents he was gonna drop out of school. The father pounded on the table. The mother hollered and she screamed. They ran him down to the doctor. Doctor, what does this mean? You put them all on Prozac, right then and right there. He said, you'll still have your problems, but now you just won't care. And he prescribed a little therapy, some supplementary drugs, but he didn't write a script out for a little more love, just a little more love. What the heck could it hurt? It might not fix nothing. At least it won't make things worse. When you're looking at your lifetime from the end, when you are done, you know it might look a little better. See a little more love. I know a wife and a husband, and they had a shiny little kid. When that kid turned 16, you won't believe what she did. She said, Mom, I'm sleeping over Susan's. That was just a big fat lie. What she really was doing was staying out all night. And when her parents found out, they cried boo-hoo-hoo. And then they called the radio talk show. They asked him, what should we do? He said, send her off to boot camp. That was his advice. It was good for his ratings, but it wasn't very nice. Just a little more love. What the heck could it hurt? It might not fix nothing. At least it won't make things worse. When you are looking at your lifetime from the end, when you are done, you know it might look a little better. See a little more love. I can see that you're a tough guy. Oh, you won't be pushed around. You're not gonna take it. You're good at putting your foot down. You might get killed by lightning. You might get hit by a truck. But if you are not that lucky, you might just wind up spending years in a rest home without a whole lot to do. But look back on what you did with the time God gave you. Just a little more love. What the heck could it hurt? It might not fix nothing. At least it won't make things worse. When you are looking at your lifetime from the end, when you are done, you know it might look a little better. Big rough tough guy to see a little more love. It might look a little better. See a little more love. And the crowd goes wild. The crowd is going wild. Player number 15 is losing it all together over there. I can see it right now.
Hey, Don, check your original sound real quick.
Okay, thanks, buddy. Yep. Thanks. Okay.
Yep.
All right, so let's see. We are here. We are. So there's a lot of folks from the church here, from Danvers. My son just moved to Danvers from Lynn. That's right. We're starting the process of our family lowering the property values out there in Lynn by moving up to Danvers. In Danvers by moving up there from Lynn. I gotta tell you, and my wife and I are thinking about selling this house here in Lynn. Maybe we'll move to Danvers too. You never know. But anyway, it's nice up there, and this is a lovely church. But because it's close to home, and a lot of folks are from the area, I think I'll play this song here. This is a song that I it's been around a long time. I'm going to play it for Phil. I know he likes it, and some of these folks here. This is a song about Lynn, Massachusetts, where I'm from. If you're coming in from some other place, I have to tell you about Lynn. Lynn is the factory town. It's where all the factories are and the tenement housing. It's where my family has been here for five generations. But it's an urban place with a few issues, I guess you'd say. You know, attitude problem, you know, which I am representative of. But it's a good place in a lot of ways. Now, so if you're not from around here, you need to know a few things. Lynn is the factory town. Nahant and Swampskid and Marblehead, those are the surrounding towns that are not like Lynn. They're different, you know. Things are a little less gritty over there. Lots of lovely people there. I'm not criticizing them. They're lovely, but they're not spending a lot of time over here with us. They're just kind of passing through. All right, so This is called I'm from Lynn. What can I say again? I probably wouldn't play this normally, but I know there's a good percentage of people from the North Shore here tonight. So let me just play this. I wrote this song in the 70s. That's right, in the 70s. And I'm still playing it, and it's still relevant. That can't be right, can it? When you write a song about Lynn, Massachusetts, it's important to use a three-chord primal rock and roll progression. That's to stimulate the latent barbarian, and I would say normally in the audience, but I guess it would be in the little squares. I was born in the city of Lynn, home of the first turbine engine. And as if that wasn't enough, it's also the home of marshmallow fluff. You can travel the whole country, you'll never find a bigger fluff factory. From Lynn, what can I say? People from Lynn act this way. Don't talk slick like I'm from the hint. I'm the son of a 30-year GE man. Don't be staring at me that way. I am from Lynn, what can I say? I used to hang around at Barry Park. That's illegal after it gets dark. Stand on the bleachers where things got smoked and beer got chug-a-lug, bottles got broke. Later in the evening when the police come, 27 juveniles are on the run. And juveniles are running everywhere you see, jumping over fences, climbing in trees. But Don White is too loaded to get away. His name is in the paper on the next day. His mother and his father, they can't believe he would publicly humiliate the family. And I say, Mom from Lynn, what can I say? People from Lynn act this way and don't talk slick. That's what I said. I am not from Swampski or Marblehead. Don't be staring at me that way. I am from Lynn, what can I say? Now on the corner of every street, somebody's cooking something greasy to eat. Deep fat is frying everywhere you look. The town is bound for the record books. It's a million sub shops open all night long. A socio-intestinal phenomenon. Socio-intestinal phenomenon. I have been writing songs since the 70s. I still think that's the best line I've ever written. I pinnacled in 1978. I'm from Lynn, what can I say? People from Lynn eat this way. There's no room in my stomach for French cuisine. Give me a bag of cheese curls and a submarine. Julia Child, get out of my way. I'm from Lynn, what can I say? Julia Child. That's how you know when a song's been around too long. When it actually has dead people in it. I left Lynn 10 years ago. I didn't know where I was gonna go. 10 of my friends were leaning against a bar and grill. You know, it's 10 years later, they're leaning there still. Half of my friends who are not on the street are dead in jail or annoying me. And I'm from Lynn, what can I say? People from Lynn act this way. I don't talk slick, that's what I said. They won't even let me into Marblehead. They're afraid I'll steal something. And I might. Don't be staring at me that way. I'm from Lynn, what can I say? There you go. Alright, bravo. Alright, here we go. All right, so this is an interesting life. I'm not real famous, but I've been able to make a living, and I've been able to travel and tour, and it's, you know, nobody in my family ever had a career like this, you know, so I feel lucky and blessed, and I don't really tell a lot of stories about what it's like to be on the road because I don't find them that interesting, but I'm going to tell you a story that happened at a show one time. So Brandon, I'm going to tell this story here. A while back, I got a gig. My daughter was, as Barbara knows, that so she used to help me with my performances. She would call me up and say, "This person wants to hire you." So she said, "I have a gig for you. It's a person in recovery. People who, it was a woman who was a recovering alcoholic, I guess, or drug addict. And I perform for a lot of people in that community. I myself personally have not had a drink since 1990. I don't want any applause or anything from that. It's all right. But it, you know, I think I would have been 20 years dead probably had I not done that. But here I am. Anyway, so that's a good hunk of my community comes from there. And I was, it was just a normal thing. And then, so it was a wedding. She was going to get married in South Boston. So 2 days before the wedding, before the show, my daughter calls me and she goes, it's not going to be a wedding anymore. I go, well, what is it? She goes, well, the something happened to the husband, you know, we don't know exactly what happened, but it's not a wedding anymore. I go, well, why am I doing it? She goes, because you're not going to believe this woman. That's what she said to me. This, I just talked to her on the phone a couple times, and she is the most extraordinary woman I ever heard of, and she doesn't care what it is. She's going to enjoy herself no matter what. So now I'm intrigued. I'm like, this is going to be interesting, right? So I drive to South Boston, and it's like, I think it was in a church basement or a VFW or something, just a plain old building with a squeaky floor, and I'm curious about this woman now. Like I assume what I was looking for was a facade. I was thinking she's just putting on a good face. Her wedding's over, and now she's having this party to celebrate one of her friends, I think it was, or her sponsor or something like that. And I'm like, I just want to, you know, I need to study this because I think nobody could possibly be actually happy to be in this situation. So as soon as I meet her, I can't find it. I'm looking, I'm like, where is the facade? She looks genuinely happy. I'm like, am I losing a step? What's going on here? You know, I should be able to figure this out, but I couldn't. She looked to be just the same as if she was at her own wedding. That, and right? And so I'm kind of charmed by her now. Her name was Joan Lynch, was her name. And first thing I noticed about her is she had these shoes on. They were like ruby red shoes with diamonds all over them. They look like you could click the heels of them and go to Oz, right? So I took my foot when I had like a pair of $10 black stupid shoes on, and I put it next to her shoe for contrast, and she took out a camera, snapped a picture of it, right? Just a picture of the two shoes. And I'm kind of charmed by her, and we're talking, and then I was supposed to go on play music after a DJ played a little bit, right? And so the DJ started playing, and as she's walking away to go to the dance floor, she said to me, I have stage 4 breast cancer, and it's in my bones. And she walked away. And I was kind of stunned, you know, and I watched her. And I had been in this situation before, where I was around somebody for whom tomorrow was not guaranteed, that it was unlikely, you know. When you're around people like that, they're kind of like holy people. And what I mean by that is that we all talk about seizing the day, carpe diem, making the most out of the minutes that you have. Everybody talks about it, you know, people write memes about it all day long. But when you're around somebody who really is that way, they're special. They're not like other people because they know they may not wake up the next day. And so when they smile at you, you never saw a smile like that. It kind of cracks the glass on your eyes. And when they hug you, oh man, you never had a hug like that before. You feel like you could just, the two of you just float up into the sky. The people like that, but people in that situation hug you like the hug that they're giving you is the only thing that is happening at that moment on planet Earth. It's not like any other thing, and I knew this. And then I watched her dance, and nobody dances like somebody for whom tomorrow is a big question mark. I was watching her, and you know how in a movie sometimes, like on a dance floor, all of a sudden they'll fade out everybody except one person. There'll just be a light on somebody, and they're just twirling as if nobody's watching. That's what it was like. So nobody danced like that, and I just knew it was an extraordinary moment. And I wrote this song for her. It's called Last Dance, and she became my pal. She ran she was involved in a woman's shelter, so we raised money for that, and she became my pal. And one time she came to my concert at Passim, and she was really sick then. She came right from the hospital. Like, she told the, against doctor's orders, she pulled herself out of the bed, unplugged herself, and came to my concert. And I have a photograph of that. She always dressed beautifully when she was up because she didn't want people to worry about her. Even if it was her only one good hour a day, she had this like multicolored scarf on, and she dressed beautifully. So this is a song for her. It's called Last Dance. Her name was Joan Marie Lynch. And we're just going to like tribute her a little bit tonight because she was great. She told me she was stage 4. She walked onto the dance floor like it was the last dance of her life. Never saw a smile so bright, never got a hug so tight, never saw a dance hall light illuminate a soul so bright. Eyes have seen a lot of things, but they never saw angel wings till they watched a woman dancing like it was the last dance of her life. Like it was the last dance, like it was the last dance, like it was the last dance of her life. I know the people love the old cliches, how everybody ought to seize the day. They post them on their social page every hour of every day. But you've gotta love the irony of sitting down at a computer screen, posting carpe diems day and night while your life goes passing by. I never saw a smile so bright, never got a hug so tight, I never saw a dance hall light illuminate a soul so bright. These eyes have seen a lot of things, but they never saw angel wings till they watched a woman dancing like it was the last dance of her life. Like it was the last dance, like it was the last dance, like it was the last dance of her life. Maybe tomorrow I will try to write a song about this precious life, but tonight I'd rather live this life than describe it while it's passing by. She told me she was stage four. She walked onto the dance floor. Her body started moving like this was the last dance of her life.
Don.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Absolutely beautiful.
Woo! Well, thank you, everybody. So I thought you said this guy was funny. What the heck was that? How was the comedy show you went to last night? It was the worst comedy show! All right. I don't know what to do here. I've been playing this song every night. I apologize to everybody who comes all the time, but I'm just having so much fun with it. There's just a little bit of punk in, like I don't know, brat in me that just loves this song right here. So I'm again, there's a fair amount of new people here tonight, so I want you to hear this. This is a song from my newest CD. It's called Live at the Guthrie Center. The Guthrie Center is the church for you, all you old hippies, where there might be a couple out there. The church where Arlo Guthrie dragged all the garbage out of and got in trouble in the movie Alice's Restaurant, or the song Alice's Restaurant. he bought the church in the 90s, and he does concerts there, and they do a lot of social work there and help the community. So I was lucky enough to record an album there last year, and this is a song from there. Now, this is for my Massachusetts people here, because this is a song about something that we are familiar with, and that is that now, just recently, in our fair state, weed is legal. And I'm okay with that. I don't smoke it myself, but I'm glad it's legal. I'm glad nobody's going to jail for it. Like, if you're, if you want to do it, go do it. It's okay. You know, it's all right. Like, it used to be kind of, quasi-legal, you know what I mean? Like, do you remember that? Like, when you used to have to get your doctor to lie about it. Like, you know, you're like, maybe, you know, Don White has anxiety and perhaps a little glaucoma. So now you had a card and you could go with your doctor's lie on it and get it. But now you just walk in the store and get it, you know. And it's okay. Again, I'm not complaining about it. I'm glad. Here's my concern. And those of you that live around here, you know this is true. This, my first concern is, you cannot go anywhere in Lynn, Massachusetts and not smell weed. Nowhere! Like, it's coming out of churches and kindergartens and police cars. It's everywhere, right? You know... If you're jogging in this town now, you need to go to rehab right from the end, at the end of your jog. Like, you get high just jogging in this town right now. And so that's one concern I have. The other concern is that I like conversation. If we were at the church tonight, during intermission, or before or after, I would be talking to you and listening to what you say and paying attention and trying to learn from you. I really like focused conversation. You know, the kind where the person you're talking to remembers what you said? You know, that kind of conversation? Well, I really like it. And now I fear that because now it's so, everybody's smoking this stuff, now I feel that there's going to be a stoner zombie apocalypse, and that that those of us that like focused conversation where the person you're talking to remembers what you said, we're going to have to go underground. We're going to have to go underground. We're going to have like speakeasies. We're going to call them speak. They're going to be called speak coherently easies. That's going to be the name of them. All right, so here we go. This is like, I'm always on the opposite side of every trend. Like, everybody's all on this, and I'm finding something to complain about it with. But just remember now. Like, I can tell that, like let's see. Square number 15, square number 17, they're smoking both of those squares now. Square number 21, they just fired up. The person in the ocean there, she's smoking like crazy. Everybody, like, I get it. You know, it's okay. Don't be concerned about it. I'm glad it's legal. I'm just saying this is my point of view regarding the quality of future conversations. That's it. That's what I'm saying here. I sat around with a bunch of stoners. I listened to them talk all night long. They were sure that their conversation was deep with meaning. They were wrong. When you smoke it, it makes you stupid. I thought you knew it, but I was wrong. We're not having a conversation. This is nothing at all. My friend Harry lit up a fatty to celebrate my brand new job. I watched his brain float out of my window. He left me talking to an empty blob. Cause when you smoke it, it makes you stupid. I thought you knew it, but I was wrong. We're not having a conversation. We're doing nothing at all. So I have to get in character for this part. So I'm gonna droop my eyes a little. Wait a second. I'm going to droop my eyes a lot. Wait a second. And I'm going to slow the guitar part down to stoner speed. Wait a second. Yeah. All right. So now we're in somebody's basement. We're in our early 20s. We're having deep thoughts. There's a lot of smoke in this room. We're having deep thoughts about the world and the future, and this is the conversation right here. We're thinking, all right, cool. What if our whole life was just a dream, man? What if we're dreaming this right now? I forgot what I was just saying. Let's order pizza. Pizza. Wow. It makes you stupid. I thought you knew it, but I was wrong. We're not having a conversation. This is nothing, nothing at all. It cures glaucoma. It cures insomnia. Some people say it is a cancer cure, but it does not incoherent conversation, that's for sure. Woo! Woo!
Woo! Awesome.
Yeah.
Ta-da! All right. No, let's order some pizza. I think that's the thing to do. All right. Okay, so we got some requests here. Let me do those after. Let's see if we can do it. All right, so this is what's going to happen. I'm going to tell a story, then we're going to take a short break. It's not really an intermission. It's just a sort of a pass the hat because we want to raise money for the concert series and the church are there and for the Don White Ramen Noodle Fund. You know, it's a very important fund that we're raising money for here today. So I'm gonna tell this story and then we're gonna take a 3-minute break. The first minute, Brandon, the first minute and a half is gonna be a public service announcement, a very important one, so I want you to pay attention to that. And then we'll put up the Venmo and the PayPal and the mailing address for those of you that want to contribute. And I say this every week and I wanna say it tonight, there's a fair amount of new people here. This is a free concert. It's if you don't have any money, you are welcome here. You are welcome at anything that I do, anytime I do it, and I mean that. I've been dirt poor a good hunk of my life, and you are always welcome at my shows. Even when we're back playing in clubs or whatever, if you don't have any money and you want to come, you call me and we'll figure out how to get you in. So anybody here tonight who's not in a situation where they can donate, don't you feel uncomfortable. I love you and I'm glad you're here. Okay, so, but if you're in a situation where you're doing okay and you want to contribute and help out the church and help out, you know, a musician that you like, then we'll put the information up there and we'll do that. So here, I want to tell this story because I know there's a lot of people from the church here, and I happen to really love the people at this church. Their hearts are big and generous, and so I want to tell this story for you guys in particular, but for everybody. I lived in Lynn all my life, but in my 20s, I moved to Maine. I moved to the state of Maine because I wanted to become famous. That's right, I moved to Maine because I wanted to become famous. it was the first in a series of really interesting business decisions on my part. It was like moving to the moon to become famous, right? So I moved to Maine. And prior to that, I had hitchhiked for 3 years. Do you believe that? You're looking at somebody who hitchhiked around the country with his girlfriend for 3 years. With his girlfriend that he's still married to. Let me start from the beginning. I'm going to say that sentence again. You are looking at someone who hitchhiked around the country for 3 years with his girlfriend that he is still married to. I think I'm the only human being on earth that could speak that sentence and be happy true. Right? But it is true. I hitchhiked around the country for 3 years with my girlfriend and then my wife. You know, we were not married at first and then married later in the thing. So before I moved to Maine, that's what I've been doing, hitchhiking. So when I got to Maine, I had no marketable skills at all. I couldn't do anything. I didn't know how to do anything. I was an excellent hitchhiker, but nobody was hiring. I kept looking through the paper, you know, no hitchhikers wanted is what it said there. And the people who lived up there in Maine, they didn't like us. They called us Flatlanders. And those of you that are from Massachusetts, you know what I'm talking about. You've heard that before, right? Flatlanders, you know what that means? If you're not from around here, if you've never been to Maine, it means you ain't from here and you ain't ever going to be from here. So it's just, you know, stop talking like you're from here. You know, you're a Flatlander. And so the guy that, and first I thought they hated us, all of them, but then I realized that we became entertainment for them. I'm sure they had a pool going, like after about a month of us living in their neighborhood. They're like writing down, who's got January 15th for the date where these two hippies freeze to death in that house over there, right? So we were their entertainment, right? And then Wilbur, the guy who lived across the street from me, his name was Wilbur. He tortured us about being not from there all the time, but he was also nice to us. That's like a main thing. Do you know what I mean? Like they can be mean to you and nice to you at the same time. I don't really understand it, but I recognize it when I see it, you know? And he was like that. He ran a hose through the culvert underneath the street from his well to our house so that we could have running water because the house had no plumbing, no running water, you know? And it had a two-seater outhouse, right? My parents, Larry and Franny White, have had many occasions to be disappointed in me over the years, but their disappointment when they came to visit me in this house and realized that there was no flushable toilet, their disappointment in me was palpable. It was palpable. You could see it. My father said to me, Donnie, I never told you this, but when you were young, I dropped you on your head and I never told anyone about it, but I think that where you live now and how you've chosen to live, I think it's a direct result of that, me dropping you when you were little. That's what he said. And then and he was saying to me, he said, what are you doing up here? I go, I'm trying to get back to the earth, dude. He goes, I don't know what that means. He goes, but if it means being dirt poor the rest of your life, you're doing a hell of a job. So my son was born in that house in 1980, right? So he was born in a house with no plumbing, no running water, and a month worth of prenatal care and a month worth of postnatal care before and after, and then a nurse and a midwife and a technician coming to the house to deliver the baby. All of that care before the actual delivery and a month after. The cost, the total price for all of that, I'm not making this up, $400, right? I had a $400 baby. Like, I had like a Walmart baby. And when he was born, we brought him to Wilbur. We said, Wilbur, because we were cocky now, we're like, Wilbur, you can say what you want about us, but this is a Mainer. He was born in that house right there. He was born in Maine. You can't call him a Flatlander. He's a Mainer. And this is what Wilbur said to me, and I want you all to listen to this because this has stayed with me all my life. It is one of the funniest and kind of meanest things I've ever heard in my life, and it will give you a good example of how razor sharp the Maine sense of humor is. So I go, Wilbur, this is a Mainer. He's born in Maine. And he goes, well, if your cat crawls in the oven and has kittens, you don't call them biscuits now, do you? Like, Wilbur, that hurt. So I got a job finally for minimum wage in a nursing home, and that's really what I want to talk about here before we take our little break. At this time in my life, I was 20 years old, and I was terrified. I woke up, as soon as I opened my eyes in the morning, my heart would start racing, and it wouldn't stop racing till I went to bed, because I was just in terror every minute of my waking day, because I couldn't imagine how I was going to be able to feed this kid. I didn't go to college, had no skills, I didn't know how to do anything. I was hitchhiking to work, I was making minimum wage, living in a house with no plumbing. You know, I just lived in terror of the future. And I got a job as a custodian in a nursing home. And it turned out to be the most important thing that ever happened to me, because I was trying to figure out what kind of man I was going to be. I was at the beginning of my adult life, and I was surrounded every day by 100 people whose stories were ending, right? So I was trying to figure out who I'm going to be, and I was looking, if you live a certain way, this is what it looks like at the end. If you live another way, this is what it looks like at the end. And I was absorbing all this, all of these stories at their end while I was at the beginning, right? And so in one corner of that building was a guy named Mr. Bishop. And to this day, he was the saddest human being I've ever laid eyes on. Think about that. I'm 63 years old. How many sad people have I met in my life? Thousands of them, right? He is by far the saddest. And it's interesting why he stayed in my memory. He wasn't evil. He didn't murder anybody. He just wasn't kind. He wasn't a kind person. He was selfish. He went to work, he had a few beers, he yelled at his wife, he went hunting, he pushed people out of the way to get the job he wanted. He was just that guy, right? Not evil, not a murderer, not a burglar, none of that. Just not generous of spirit. The thing that made him so sad was that he was smart enough to know at the end of his life, when it was too late to do anything, that nothing he did in his life was going to give him any peace when he looked back on it. He would have given me his whole life savings if I could have sent him back for a month just to spread I love yous around, or let me help yous around, so that he could hold them in his hands as memories and feel good about them. But there was none of that, and it was too late. And he was tragic, like Shakespearean tragic. He was tragic in my mind, like Macbeth is tragic, right? And I hated going in his room. There was this dark cloud over him all the time, and it was just, I just hated it in there. And on the other side of the building was Mattie Campbell. Mattie Campbell was 89 in 1978. Right? So she was born in the 1890s. And in her room, the sun was always shining. I thought she had a southern exposure. It wasn't that. The light was coming from her. She lived a life opposite of Mr. Bishop. It was just decade upon decade of kindness and generosity. And when she looked back at it, she didn't need to change a single minute of it. She just looked back at it and smiled and shined. There was just light coming off of her because her life made sense to her and she didn't need to change any of it. And she adopted me. She adopted me. I would get my work done in like 2 hours, you know, janitor. And I would take my chair and sit it next to her bed, and she would just teach me these things from this amazing life. You know, I'm 20 years old and being mentored by somebody almost 90, right? And I would complain about how hard my life was. And, you know, and she would, I was, you know, I feel bad about it now. I was complaining about having to hitchhike up and down the road to work and to a woman who didn't see a combustion engine till she was 40 years old, probably, right? Lived in the most frozen hunk of, you know, wilderness that there was in this country, you know, but I did it. And then I would complain and she would listen to me with her eyes closed. You know how the elderly will listen with their eyes closed like that? And then I would finish complaining about how hard my life was, and she'd open one eye and say to me, "Are you sure you're being honest with yourself?" And I would muster some sort of weak response, and she would go like this, just wave me off. She'd go think about that. Like, go think about that. I'm tired. Come back tomorrow. And she was funny, like really funny. Like, I would have loved her if she wasn't funny, but being funny really, really pushed me over the edge with her. It just made me just, you know, it just made it perfect. One time she handed me a piece of paper. I go, "What's this?" She goes, "This is my epitaph." I opened it up and it said, "Here lies Maddie. She had a million ills. It wasn't those that killed her. It was the half a million pills." So I loved her. And, you know, before I wrap this story up, I just want to give you an example of how she taught me things. Because what happened was, little by little, she would teach me about, like, life lessons. And slowly I could see, I could feel that the racing in my heart was slowing down. And I began to imagine that even maybe someone like me might be able to manifest a life that they could be proud of someday. So one day I was complaining to her about having to borrow money from my parents. I had to borrow $400 to pay my rent, and I knew they'd give it to me, but I was so sick of asking people for help, and I was complaining to Maddie. I was like, "I don't want to ask people for help anymore, Maddie. I want to be able to do this on my own. I can't stand asking people for help anymore." And she said, "It is your responsibility to let the people who love you help you." And I said, "No, it is not my responsibility to do that." And she said, "How do you feel when you are in a position to help somebody that you love?" I go, "That's different." I go, "I like that feeling." She goes, She said, do you love it? I go, as a matter of fact, I do love it. She goes, then why would you deny the people who love you this feeling that you love so much? And I'm telling you, it made something pop inside my brain. Like I could feel synapses being created to accommodate a new piece of information that I promise you I wouldn't have come across on my own until I was 50 years old. And gently, she just fed me these little pieces of wisdom. And all of a sudden, I began to think of myself as somebody who might be able to make a life that he could be proud of. And then Maddie Campbell died. She died, and I was heartbroken. I was heartbroken. I knew I had to put my big boy pants on now and figure this stuff out for myself. Nobody's going to wave me off and tell me to go think about it. I had to do it myself. And that night, I had a dream, and in the dream, Maddie was in the dream. And when I walked over to her in this dream, she had her hands cupped like this. And when I got close to her, she opened them up, and I looked down, and there inside of her hands were thousands of sparkling diamonds. And I knew it. I knew it in the dream. I knew it at 20 years old. I knew exactly what was happening. Every moment in this life when you do the right thing because it's the right thing to do, not because you want something back, every moment in this life when you do the kind thing, it gets compressed into a diamond. And Maddie Campbell's last gift to me was to show me these the thousands and thousands of sparkling moments of a life well lived. Not so I could see how many there were, but so that I could see the peace on her face at the end of her life as she gazed upon her life's moments and how beautiful they were and how well she spent her time. This is what it looks like. This is what a face looks like when it's happy with the way it lived. And it was the most generous gift to me. I mean, it didn't really happen. It was a dream. But let's just say that it impressed me even in the dream, right? And then at the end, she whispered something into my ear, which I've thought about all my life. And I want to say it to you now. Let Maddie speak through me. She would be 130 years old now. So you would have no way of knowing her. But as a gift to her for being so important in my life, I just want to let her talk through me and say to you the one thing that she said to me in this dream that I've never forgotten. She whispered right here in this ear. She goes, in the end, the person with the most diamonds wins.
Woo! Woo! Thank you, Don.
You're welcome. All right, thanks, so Maddie again, Campbell. Say it again.
Thanks, Maddie Campbell.
Oh, Maddie, I wish she was here. She wouldn't tolerate any of you. She'd just like wave you all off. You know? So we're going to do a 3-minute break. Again, sorry for those of you that have seen this before, but for the new folks here, the first minute and a half is going to be a very important public service announcement because we try to be helpful here at the Don White Thursday Night Program. And we want to make sure that you are safe out there in the world. And so we want you to pay close attention to this public service announcement. And then we are going to put up the information where you can donate if you are able to. And that'll take 3 minutes total. And then I'll be back and I'll play till 20 past, maybe 25 past. Okay. Thanks, everybody, and we'll see you in just a minute.
This car has been stopped for quite some time. I'm going to check it out. Excuse me. Have you been smoking any pot today?
No.
Well, you've been stopped here for 15 minutes. Can you tell me why that is?
We're waiting for the stop sign to turn green.
How high are you?
How are you?
No, I said, how high are you?
Hi, how are you? This cop is so friendly, babe.
Okay, I am going to have to conduct a pot sobriety test.
Oh, man, I'm too high for that.
Blow into this.
Hey, is that a breathalyzer?
No. Okay, now I'm going to ask you a few questions to determine your ability to drive. Why is a pizza box square when the pizza's a circle and all the little slices are tiny triangles? Which of these two snacks would you prefer? Chips or the cookie dough? Step out of the car, please. Let's go.
Please, don't drive high. We're getting cookie dough all over the back of our cruisers. a message from the Royal Canadian Mounted Police.
Hi there, everyone. Hello. Welcome back. Didn't seem like we lost too many. That's a good sign. Did we have, did somebody request something? Let me just take a look here. Oh, there we go. Okay. Let's see what I can do on those. All right. All right, so I'm going to do another 15 minutes. So that's going to put us into about 25 past time frame. You're okay with that? And then you can hang around if you want. We'll have a little after party and some guests and get Tim Foley back and all that. I lost my mother. I lost my father. Well, I really did. Know exactly where they both are. It's not like they went for a walk, took a wrong turn and both got lost. It just hurts less to say I lost them than to say they're dead. Betty May is 82. She's having more fun than me and you. All she wants to do is laugh and sing. She's the biggest flirt I ever seen. Still flutters over baby blues like she did when she was 22. So much mischief in those eyes. I never seen someone more alive. More alive, more alive. Waiting on the other. sorrow and the trouble in your life. There are so many sad goodbyes in a long and well-lived life. If they don't break you, they can make you more alive. When my mother died, I was so smashed up inside. I was crying like a baby. I thought the pain might kill me. And Betty said, son, you won't believe how many loved ones I buried. My father, sister, my brother, son, my husband, and my mother. And every time I lose a friend, I think I'm never going to laugh again. I lay around and watch bad TV till this feeling comes over me. And then I put some music on and play my favorite song. Dance around my living room like I did when I was 22. Shake loose of that pain inside on the day when I decide. Not only will I survive, I'm going to be more alive. More alive, more alive. Waiting on the other side of all the sorrow and the trouble in your life. There are so many sad goodbyes in a long and well-lived life. If they don't break you, they can make you more alive. She said, go ahead, feel your pain. Watch bad TV for days. But when you're ready to come out and play, you'll come see Betty May. And we'll put some music on and play your favorite song. Dance around my living room like we both were 22. Shake loose of that pain inside on the day when you decide. Not only will you survive, you're going to be more alive. More alive, more alive. Waiting on the other side of all the sorrow and the trouble in your life. There are so many sad goodbyes in a long and well-lived life. If they don't break you, they can make you more alive. There are so many sad goodbyes in a long and well-lived life. If they don't break you in time, they can make you more alive.
All right.
Thanks, Don. Love it. Woo!
Thank you, and the crowd goes wild. All right. All right. So let me just practice something for a second here. Somebody's asked for this for 2 weeks, and I haven't played it in 20 years. I'm not sure I can. All right, I'm gonna take a stab at this. This is, I think this is the song that the person who's requesting it wants. It's a, it's really called Terry's Christmas Memories, and Christmas, I don't think people realize how hard Christmas is on poor people. Like my wife's, you know, they didn't have money when they were little. So, you know, what does that do inside a house? You know, what does it do to kids? What does it do to the parents who don't have money to, and they see all these other kids getting everything, and the little kid doesn't understand why they didn't get anything for Christmas, but other kids who maybe aren't good kids or doing bad things, they get good stuff. It's like, it's a really hard, stressful time. And so when we had our kids, we didn't have much money, but she would max out the credit cards to make sure that they got the Christmas that she, that her family was not able to give her. You know, they were working hard as they could, but they were, you know, poor people, right? They didn't have, you know, didn't have enough. Right? And so, and I would complain about it, and she'd just tell me to shut up. Be like, you know, I'm getting my Christmas through watching these kids get this. You figure out how to make money. So that was the thing. And so that's what this song is about. Again, I think I can get through it, but whoever is asking for this, thank you for asking for it. I assume this is the one that you want, but... I said, baby, are you crazy? I know it's Christmas, but we can't keep spending our money like this. And she said, just sit a minute and I'll tell you something about my Christmas memories. She said, I'm not complaining, I'm just saying, back then we had no money, and that Christmas was difficult on my family. And I remember December full of tension back then, and I am not going to feel that again. Good memories are what we need when we're old, to have and to hold when we feel alone. And my gift forever this family will be great Christmas memories. Our kids will never know what it's like to hear their parents fight about money at night. And by giving these children these great memories, they give great memories to me. Good memories are what we need when we are old, to have and to hold when we feel alone. And my gift forever to this family will be great Christmas memories. Those of you that know her, you can just picture her saying the first line of this right here. So quit whining, quit crying, quit running your mouth about credit cards, landlords, and low bank accounts. 'Cause nothing that you can say will ever keep me from making great Christmas memories. And good memories are what we need when we are old, to have and to hold when we feel alone. And my gift forever to this family will be great Christmas memories. Great Christmas memories. There you go.
Woo! You did it! Awesome!
I did it. Wow, I love that.
Nice.
A little Christmas, you know, in this room I'm in right now, it's 130 degrees, so Christmas song seems about appropriate, really, I think. But all right. So now this is going to be the end of my part of this program here. Play one more song. I want to thank Barbara especially, but everyone at the church, excuse me, for working so hard to get the word out and for doing the good work that the church does in the community. It's a really fantastic place over there, and I can't wait to be with you all again. So those of you that are not muted, make some noise like this. All right, so here, I'll play this tune, and then we'll take another 2-minute break. Just throw the information up there so you can donate to the church and to the Dawn White Family Ramen Noodle Fund, and then we'll be back for an after party. You don't have to stay for it, but Sarah will tell you it's usually worth staying for.
Don't miss it.
Don't miss it, says Sarah. And we got some friends popping in, and Tim's going to come back and sing a song, and we'll see who's in the crowd, what's going on. And it's informal, and it's kind of like we close the door in the club, and we let the audience hang around with the band after, kind of like that. So if that sounds intriguing to you, you're welcome to stay. But don't, you know, go, if you got a long drive home, you know, down the hallway and into the living room, go ahead, get a head start on that. All right? So... This song is called It's a Great Day to Not Be Dead.
Woo! Woo! Yes.
It's a pretty pretty hard sentiment to argue with, no matter what side of the political spectrum you find yourself on. So you got your friend that you went to school with, and all of a sudden you're looking at his Facebook page and you're wondering, like, what happened to that guy? You know? And every time you see each other, there's a lot of tension because of the way the world is. The next time you see your friend and, you know, that you don't agree on things, walk right up to him and say, "Hey, you," and he'll say, "Yeah, you," and you say to him, "It's a great day to not be dead," and he'll say, "Yeah, well, yes." And then you start your civil dialogue. Like that could happen. All right, here we go. I was on the highway, I was cruising along, I decided to put my seatbelt on. A minute later, baby, what do you believe? A Big Mac truck crashed into me. I told the policeman that I was okay. He said, "Your seatbelt saved your life today." The ambulance driver, the EMT, they all started singing this song to me. They said, "It's a great day to not be dead. Shoo-be-doo-wah, shoo-wah, shoo-wah. To not cave in your windshield with your head. Cave in your windshield with your head. You're an ugly man, but if that occurred, believe me, you would be even uglier. And it's a great day to not be dead. Shoo-be-doo-wah, shoo-wah, shoo-wah." You know, many years ago, I saw a news story on my TV set about a guy whose wife brought a knife to bed. Anybody old enough to remember that guy?
Bobbitt.
What was his name?
Bobbitt.
Mr. Bobbitt, that's right. 1 hour later, as the story goes, a part of his anatomy was laying by the road. And my sassy wife looked over and smiled at me. Started singing this song to me. She said, "Hey, it is a great day to not be dead. Shoo-be-doo-wah, shoo-wah, shoo-wah. To not have your wife bring a knife with her to bed. Shoo-be-doo-wah, chop, chop, whoa." Not that funny. She said, "I yell and I scream, I complain a lot, but at least I haven't cut no body parts off. And it's a great day to not be dead. Shoo-be-doo-wah, shoo-wah, shoo-wah. You know, not cutting body parts off is a pretty good quality in a wife, really, when you think about it. So I'm looking across all the squares now, and I see a lot of couples. If you're with somebody tonight in a little square that you've been with for many years, and you're still put together anatomically the same way you were when you first met, I don't think it's inappropriate to say thank you." Oh, look, we're having little tender moments all across the squares right now. Thought about my car crash, my close call, and I started getting sentimental. I said, "I love this house, I love you guys, I even love my rusty old car outside, and I'm so happy to be alive with you. Let's do all the things we always said that we would do. Maybe we'll buy a house in Danvers, you never know. Is this a great day? It is a great day. It is a great day. It is a great day. It's a great day to not be dead." Thank you for everything.
All right, John.
Thursday night is another one in the can, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you to everybody for coming out. So again, we'll take just a 2 minute break. I'll go splash some water on my face, and we'll see who shows up for the after party. We'll have a little song swap. We'll get Tim Foley to come out here and play some more of that fantastic guitar, and we'll just manufacture community. Right? That's the thing. We're isolated now, but we can use this technology to to manufacture something that resembles community, and that's what I'm interested in. So I'll be back in a little while, and we'll be chatting and talking and singing, and just the way we would if we were really together in the flesh. So I'll see you in just a couple minutes.
I missed that. Danvers, Massachusetts. Back, did you miss me? You know you did. So I changed my shirt because we do costume changes at this show here. That's right. It's like Vegas. This is like Vegas here. Yeah. We do costume changes. Everything.
Fashionista.
Fashionista. That's right. If you let's see. So this is the after party. It looks very much like the actual concert at this moment, but. So the way we start usually is we bring back our opener, and he's been waiting patiently since 7 o'clock or thereabouts. So let's welcome back our friend Tim Foley to get him to play a song for us. Come on now, Tim. There he is. You're gonna have to unmute yourself, Tim.
Yep, there you go.
All right, good deal.
Nice. It wasn't patiently, it was very enjoyable, Don.
Well, thank you. You know, why don't you play a song? We'll go around a couple times, and when we go around the second time, we'll talk a little bit about your history and music and all that. But for now, why don't you get us started with a tune?
Okay, I'm going to do an instrumental. No singing. This is called Southold Morning.
Wonderful. Tim, thank you so much. Will you hang around or we go around one more time? But play another song for us one more time around. Thanks a lot, buddy. And we'll chat a little bit there. So now I want to introduce to you somebody that lives around here, is just an extraordinary musician and songwriter. And she's got a pretty big gig coming up tomorrow. So I asked her to come and pop in. And, oh, there you go. There you go. That was awesome. anyway, was that her?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Let's give her a minute.
That sounded like Tom.
You know, you know what it could have been? Like, she's working on her phone, right? It could have been someone calling her, right? Like, that happens too, right? When you're working on your phone. All right. Anyway, so Danielle, where are you? Are you? Can you got it together?
Hello. I did get a text in the middle of that. Sorry about
right.
that. But you're also hearing. You might hear a little bit of Tom in the other room because we didn't account for the fact that we have two concerts in the same night in the same house.
You have to be good and loud. You're gonna outshout Tom Bianchi. That's not easy.
Yeah, I'm gonna do that, and we're gonna crash his party in a little bit too. If you want to, we'll crash his set.
Oh yeah, let's do that.
Yeah.
Bring your phone over, and we'll go over and crash his set. All right. So this is Danielle Morelia, a fantastic musician, and Danielle, you want to talk about what you're doing tomorrow night and where it is?
Yeah, I'm doing my first live, like actual real live in-person gig in four or five months, whatever, how long this has been going on. It's a drive-in thing in at the Mass, oh God, MMAS. Wait, I keep forgetting the actual, like, I just call it MMAS, but it's the Mass Music and Art Society. But they have a great setup there. They've got a drive-in situation, or you can sit outside your car in a lawn seat and stay distanced from everybody. And it's like, yeah. So I've been really picky, but that's the only gig I've taken, you know, because it has to be super safe. And So I'm a little nervous because I haven't played a live show in 4 months. But
we're gonna put all your information in the chat so people can drive up there, and you know, they can get inside their plastic bubbles and drive
exactly
up there and see you that tomorrow night. Why don't you play?
Yeah, please do.
Play something for us and drown out that turkey of her husband.
All right, I'm gonna do. All right, I'm gonna play. I'm putting out I'm about to put out an acoustic folk blues album with Viztone Records, and it's coming out in October. And there's a lot of blues covers on there, and just like a couple of originals and a bunch of covers. And so I'm gonna do one of the old blues covers here. So this is a song originally done by Tampa Red. And oh, Brandon, I have changed my sound situation a little bit. I put my earbuds in because I didn't think I'd be able to hear you guys otherwise because of the double gigging over here, double books. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, but before you start, if you don't mind, can you just, like, I love to watch you play, so can you just push it so that I can see your guitar?
Yeah, I can get a little farther back now that I have my earbuds in. I don't know how great it's going to sound, but you'll at least get that.
All right, go ahead.
Can you hear that guitar?
Yeah,
we hear it.
All right. I can't be satisfied. When things go wrong, so wrong with you, it hurts me too. So run here, baby, put your little hand in mine, 'cause I got something to tell you. I know that will change your mind. When things go wrong, so wrong with you, it hurts me too. Now when you go home, I know you don't get along. Just come back to me, baby. Where I live, that's your home. When things go wrong, so wrong with you, it hurts me too. Nothing in this world like you. When things go wrong, so wrong with you, it hurts me too. So now you know. It hurts me too.
Wow.
Woo!
That's how you do that.
Yeah. Wow, Danielle, that's amazing.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Danielle, if we go around one more time, will you hang around and play another song for us?
Absolutely. Oh, absolutely.
You're the best. All right. Wow. So we're going to mute you because you're noisy.
Okay, sorry.
All right. So I had originally asked my friend Haley Reardon to be here tonight, and she said she would, but then she called me and said she was on the road and couldn't make it. So Haley Reardon, for those of you that were expecting to see her, she promised me she'll pop in at another one some other time. Let me play this one for Sarah. This is for my wife who grew up in federal housing here. It's called Project Girl.
Yeah.
All the days of her youth were spent in housing subsidized by the government. By the time that her neighbors were 12 years old, they knew how to steal automobiles and play that rock and roll. Shoo-wop, shoo-wadi-wadi, Project Girl. Shoo-wop, shoo-wadi-wadi, oo-doo-wah-doo-wah. Shoo-wop, shoo-wadi-wadi, Project Girl. Shoo-wop, shoo-wadi-wadi, oo-doo-wah-doo-wah. I was raised on the other side with the white picket fences and a brand new bike. When the sun was hot and the days were long, my dad turned on the sprinkler to save the lawn. But now I'm grown and I work all day. When I come home, I'm homegrown and don't play with my Project Girl. Puts me in my place, calls me a middle class spoiled brat right to my face. Shoo-wadi wadi Project Girl. Shoo-wa, shoo-wadi wadi, oo-doo-wa-doo-wa. Shoo-wa, shoo-wadi wadi Project Girl. Shoo-wa, shoo-wadi wadi, oo-doo-wa-doo-wa. Now by the time that she married me, she was already adept at austerity, and she can keep us going on my piddly pay. She can cook a potato 119 ways. Wadi wadi Project Girl. Shoo-wa, shoo-wadi wadi, oo-doo-wa-doo-wa. Shoo-wa, shoo-wadi wadi Project Girl. Shoo-wa. I love my Project Girl, Project Girl. I love my Project Girl. If my young daughter hates what we eat, she is liable to pick it up and throw it at me. Well, the projects have never been her home, but her mother gave her Project Chromosome. So it don't matter where she may live, she will always be a second generation Project kid. Shoo-wadi-wadi Project Girl. Shoo-wop, shoo-wadi-wadi, oo-doo-wadi-wa. Shoo-wop, shoo-wadi-wadi Project Girl. Shoo-wop, shoo-wadi, I love my Project Girl. Classy women in their fancy clothes, they are very impressive, I suppose. But I wouldn't trade my Project Girl for every Maserati mama in this whole wide world. There you go.
Alright, done.
Woo! Alright. So I think we'll go through one more time, but I wanna ask my friend here, let's see what kind of shape my friend Tim is in. Is that you, Tim? Tim Mason, are you? Unmute yourself there, buddy, and talk to me for a second. Danielle, did you know Tim Mason from the old Vienna? Was that before your time here? There he is, right there. So, hi, Tim.
Tim's a good buddy. Shannon! Shannon's there, too! Yay!
They're coming in from New Mexico. Look at them. They're getting younger all the time. How's that work?
Shannon, you look exactly the same.
Yeah,
exactly the same.
I'm taller, though.
So Tim, I thought if your audio wasn't too dreadful, then maybe I could get you to do like a short poem. How's that sound? Tim's a fantastic poem. Maybe like something, you know, in the 3-minute zone or 4-minute zone, the chocolate one or something, you know, just something. So, well, how do you feel about that?
Well, let's give it a try. How's the sound?
So far it's okay, Tim. I think you're going to have to make sure you face the microphone the whole time, I guess, is the thing.
It's the microphone. Okay, see if I can perform like this.
Yeah, sure.
Oh, boy. Okay, chocolate. Let's see if I can. It's been ages now since I performed, but when I started working at a place called the Coffee Kingdom, and I got to hone part of my presentation skills by describing the dessert. And this amazing dessert. So I was sort of like a pusher. It was chocolate. It was a heart of chocolate, cheesecake, mousse, cookie and pie, homemade hot fudge dribbling over the chocolate croissant, draped over the chocolate Haagen-Dazs. Oh, chocolate thing. Take us into the heart of chocolate where the calories are natural and don't amount to much if you count by threes. Swiss and Belgium, Godiva, Dove, chipped from 50-pound blocks into chunks, wrapped in cookie dough, baked, served warm. Only one bite takes us into the heart of chocolate.
Oh, man, yeah! Woo!
Yeah!
You know... The after party, I haven't heard that since I was in the OVN, or what was that, 96 or 7 or something like that? Oh, man.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Tim.
Now we want pizza and chocolate.
Yeah, we need the chocolate to hand out now.
Yeah, right. That's not fair. No, you got to share. All right, so Tim Foley, what do you think, buddy? Would you let's talk a little bit, you and I. So when you first showed up here in Lynn a while back, and I believe that you had come from New Orleans, is that right? New Orleans, am I right about that?
Yes, I lived down in New Orleans a few years down there. Yeah.
And where did you grow up, Tim?
Well, by the time I was 7, my parents moved from New Jersey to Virginia, and then we landed in Ashland, Mass, and then ended up going to school from 2nd grade through college, lived in Framingham.
Oh, good.
Shoppingham, Framing Mall.
Framing Mall.
But I was born on the Melrose Wakefield Hospital, and now I'm living in Wakefield.
All right.
And someone looking at my birth certificate would say, oh, you just moved down the street.
Right.
But I went the long way, Vermont, New Hampshire.
Full circle.
And I ended up back here.
So your music is really diverse, and your guitar playing style is all, you know, it's just encompasses a lot of different styles. You want to talk about early influences, or who really lit a fire on you when you were young, or like that, just for a few minutes?
Well, growing up in Framingham, it was sort of bland. There was rock and roll, of course, but I kept hearing about this thing called blues. But I didn't have anyone near me to tell me, yeah, hear this. This is blues. So. I heard the Allman Brothers, Ain't My Cross to Bear, and I said, oh, this probably is blues, so I'm going to go with that. Cool. And so the Allman Brothers started me off in learning about the blues. And then, you know, they mentioned T-Bone Walker, and then I went back.
Right. That's something I like about a lot of the rock bands from the 60s, especially in the 70s, is that they were good about letting people know their influences so we could find out about them. The Rolling Stones were good about that, too. So, yeah, T-Bone, yeah. All right.
Yeah.
How about another tune?
All right. Well, this is a song about leaving New Orleans. I think... I had played to too many bartenders and not an audience. That's pretty much was my musical existence in New Orleans. I had a regular gig at the Spotted Cat on Frenchman Street with a gentleman named Taka. And sometimes Shu would join us. So Shu was, so we were known as the Tim Taka Shu Trio. And she was interested. He'd play soprano sax and bongos at the same time. And two Japanese fellows who were just sponging up all the musical influences. So my father had called and he said, well, I've got 6 months to live. And that was a good enough reason to head out. And so this is a song about leaving New Orleans. It's called What You Never Had. Shrinks like a blurry view of a wall. Is this a feeling for what I left behind me? On this bridge to Slidell's, to learn from the call. Never looked inside to see what I gave you. Thank you.
was intense.
Woo! I sort of get lost in that tune, so it's different all the time.
Yeah.
That was awesome, Tim. So, Tim's information, how you can find out what's going on with him, is in the chat, and it's down toward the bottom if you scroll down. Tim Foley, his website and all of that. So, Tim, thank you for bringing such great energy and music to this thing. Let's hear it again for Tim Foley, everybody. Yeah.
Thank you, Don White.
Hey.
You're welcome.
Hey, Daniel.
All right. So,
it's for a good cause.
That's right. Ramen noodles. Yeah. The
ramen noodles? Churches and ramen noodles. What else is there?
Don, when did it change from the magical wish list to the ramen noodle fund?
I don't know. In my 50s, I guess, maybe. In my 50s, Brad. These are inside jokes now, just for Sarah and Tim and those that go back with me a while. Now, Danielle.
Oh, yeah.
Let's hear what this musician has to say. So, Danielle, I want to chat with you a little bit, too. So, you're from Revere and I'm from Lynn, so we got that in common, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. The North Shore. So you're kind of crackly there. Is that your speaker?
Am I? That's because I just, I'm okay now, I think.
You're okay now.
Am I still crackly?
No, you're good. Who were you looking up to before you hit the stage, you know, when you were just practicing at your house? Like, I know Mick Jagger was one of them, right?
Yeah, well, it's funny. Tim's story about finding the blues through the Allman Brothers is very similar to mine, where I was, you know, a big classic rock fan. I loved the Stones and Janis Joplin, and that was like, then you find out, you know, what made them, and then you dig farther and farther back, and you find the blues. So it's very similar kind of thing. I mean, you know, if you're going to... if you like those bands, then you kind of have to kind of understand where it all came from. So
right. So with Janis, yeah, it would have been Big Mama Thornton, right?
Absolutely. Big Mama Thornton, Bessie Smith. Yeah. And then, you know, the Stones, it's like, you know, without Muddy Waters or T-Bone Walker, as Tim mentioned, you know, there's so many, I'm still learning about new old people. You know, I'm always digging further and further back and just, oh, okay, well, who influenced this one? Right now I'm reading the Robert Johnson, the biography that his sister put out. She had a photo of him that had never been released. And it's the cover of this new book that just came out. And it's really cool to read about, you know, just read a personal story of somebody who actually knew him, you know, because you think of him as this mythological figure. And meanwhile, he was really close with his family. And yeah, he like, you know, he traveled and he toured, but he was very close with his family and his loved ones. And so it's just interesting to get close and personal that way, you know.
What's the name of that book?
It's called Brother Robert.
Yeah, I'd have to check that out.
Yeah.
Did you ever hear Clapton tell the story? He said, when I was young, I was such a snob. I'd be talking to people, and as soon as I realized that they didn't know who Robert Johnson was, I'd just turn around and walk away.
Yeah. Well, and ironically, a lot of people who are big Clapton fans probably don't listen to Robert, don't even know that they're supposed to also listen to Robert Johnson.
You know. The 27 songs that he recorded that influenced the whole rock and roll and blues, yeah. All right, so what do you got?
All right, I'll do one more. So this is, I wrote this a few years ago, and now, sadly, I think it could possibly be a new national anthem. Set the bar too high. If you want to reach your goals before you die, aim low. Don't try to fly. You won't be crying in your pillow because you couldn't touch the sky. Low expectations are the key to happiness. If you can coast to mediocre, why battle for the best? Aim low. swim in the smaller ponds. You're never gonna get the gold. Try for the bronze, aim low. Why break a sweat? Go on and phone it in. Set it and forget. Don't bother trying to bring God down from the sky. You got your own dance moves and a little car to drive, aim low. You're not as special as Mama said. So drive on smoother roads, clear that ego from your head. You know, I sat outside their window with a boombox and a sign, but my dream still didn't want me, so I'm stepping out of line. And I lay him low. No, I won't try to fly. You won't see me crying in my pillow just cause I couldn't touch the sky. Aim low. I'm not even gonna write a last verse. Just gonna go binge watch some Netflix show. Make the last verse the same as the first. Aim low. Don't set the bar too high. If you wanna reach a goal before you die, aim low. Aim low. Aim low, sweet chariot. Aim low, sweet chariot. Aim low. Thank you. Thanks for having me, Don.
Daniel, always good to see you. You know, anytime you got anything to promote, just pop in. Even if I'll just drag you out of the squares for a tune, even if we're packed, you know.
Okay.
You're always welcome. And let's hear it again. Thanks, for Danielle Morales, please.
Thank you. What do you say? Do you want me to crash Tom's set in there? Yeah. He's in between songs. Want to do it?
Yeah, drag your phone over there. Let's go. Let's go.
All right, let's do it. Before he starts. Before he starts the next song.
Yeah.
Yo, are we doing this?
We're here to crash your set.
So Danielle is crashing
his set. This is payback for what he was doing to you during sound check.
This is my show right here, okay?
This show's happening at once now.
You know what? I'm going to need the stool. Can I have the stool?
This is Tom Bianchi, ladies and gentlemen. Hi, Tom.
Hi, Tom.
Hey, Tom. Multitasking, are you?
That's Tim Mason right there. How about that?
Hey, Tim. What's happening, man?
Hey, just checking it out. Zooming in.
Is there any weirdness going on with sound loops or anything with the?
Oh, are you streaming two shows right now? That's amazing.
I'm streaming on my computer is right here. I'm looking at my people, and now I'm looking at you guys.
Yeah, nothing weird going on. Sounds good. Awesome. I think this is a first. I think this is a Thursday night live stream first.
Tens of dollars.
All right, Tom, play something for streams that are going in multiple directions in multiple parts of the world.
Lightning quick. Here you go. Can you hear the bass and my voice? Does it sound okay?
Yes.
Yes.
Great. All right.
Welcome to streams, folks.
I was in the crowd gathering business. I met you at the door and shook your hand. We'd pack them in tight, we'd hug, we'd kiss. The lights would go down and the singers would spit love and lyrics and everyone swooned shoulder to shoulder in a crowded room. I'd share the mic with the band. Everybody dancing, give us a hand. We gave you a show and you gave us money. Now the doors are shut and the shit ain't funny. I'm searching looking for a clue. The family's getting hungry and the rent is due. people on the internet, trying to keep it light so we might forget that the world's gone completely mad. And this ain't fun. We're having to wipe down and sanitize everything. Smile through a mask, keep your hands real clean. The world is completely fucked. I'm out of a job and I'm out of luck. I'm hoping that a song's worth a buck or two. And I mean it when I say thank you. True story. Spent a ridiculous amount of money so I can get the very best internet that I could possibly find at home. My money on gadgets so I can plug in all of my guitars and microphones and things. Once again, I'm a self-artist fulfilling meme. Spending thousands of dollars to play for tips to the masses through a screen. Trying to be sincere through a choppy feed. Read your comments and lose my place. Can't believe the screen froze with that look on my face. PayPal, Venmo, good for bucks. But you can't see my links because my backdrop sucks. Zoom fatigue is all I know. Either way, it's okay because I need the dough. While I'm kicking down people on the internet, trying to keep it light so we might forget that the world's gone completely mad. And this ain't fun. We're having to wipe down and sanitize everything. Smile through the mask, keep your hands real clean. The world is the world is completely fucked. I'm out of a job and I'm out of hoping that a song's worth a buck. And I mean it when I say thank you. Brand new song. I mean it when I say thank you. Here we go. I mean it when I say thank you. And I don't mind when you talk through my song on Zoom. Thank you. Or explain to me all the tech problems I already knew, but I'm in the middle of the song. I can't do anything about it right now. I gotta wait till the song's over. But thank you all 8 people that told me my vocal's too loud and the guitar's not loud enough. Thank you. Thank you. What's the next one? Or take your money back because I could not honor a request. True story. Hey, I'm doing my best to remember for every 1,000 people out there like yous that are cool, there's always gonna be one tool. But I know this is Don's show and it's not you. Everybody out there tonight on this live stream, I'm sure is really cool. Please wear your mask, don't be a fool. I know underneath it gets all humid and it makes you drool. There's like a million stock jokes I could put into this section, but I think we're all tired of every single fucking mask joke, especially the one about the stick your fucking nose back in that mask. What do you think you are? Nostradamus, trying to predict that this is not a pandemic. You're a freaking moron, it's a pandemic. Your nose in your mask, don't be a tool. And when you're all masked up and keeping your distance, I really like to say thank you. Sing it with me.
I really like to say thank you.
I know it's chaos when people do that, but I like to do it anyway. And I concentrate on playing the song, and everybody's like, blah, 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 and there's always a lot of noise. And I like the chaos. That's true. People on the internet, I'm trying to keep it light so you might forget. I'm shaking down people on the internet, I'm trying to keep it light so we might forget. Yeah. My show. I really feel weird when I was like, oh God, I got to do a show Thursday night. And Don just showed me how to do this really cool Zoom thing with all you people involved. And I'm like, what have I done? Now I'm doing a show on Thursday too. I'm a jerk. Yeah.
Bravo. Tommy.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
Wow.
Thank you so much.
No. I gotta just say, you really have to come to the after party. You have to come because there is no telling what's gonna happen. All right.
Well, I didn't think we could break into another stream, but we did it.
Woo! You know, I feel like
I hear you too. Right. Love you, people.
All right. Danielle, thank you so much, Danielle. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Tim. All right. All right, I'm calling it. This thing's over. Let's see. There's nothing we can do after that. That is it. Tom has set the bar in a place. I don't want to say he set it too high. He just set it someplace that we can't get near it. Danielle, I love you. You know that. Thank you for coming. And Tim Foley, fantastic work tonight. And let's hear for Brandon and Brian Dozer doing the tech behind the scenes. Nice job, everybody.
Hey, Brandon. Hey, Brian.
Let me play one and then we'll call it. Next Thursday, I don't know who I'm partnering with, but I'm gonna perform next Thursday. And you know, if you have somebody that you that we could raise money for, give me a shout out. I got an opening for next Thursday. And then but I'm gonna play, you know, no matter what. We'll raise money for something. Who wants to hear something?
Elijah.
All right. Sarah, I will play anything for you because you come every week. And I know you got a new job coming. I don't know how I'm going to do this without you. I really don't.
I don't know how I'm going to do it without you, honey.
You know, we're going to have to train somebody to be like Sarah. You know? like loving everybody, telling everybody that they're great, shouting out, but you know, enthusiasm just beaming out of box number 15 over there. You know, I just love you, Sarah. I really do. You're the best. And good luck with your new job and see us when you can, all right?
Thank you.
All right, so this is a terrible song to end with, but I'll do it for you, Sarah. All right. Let me tell you about the fall of 79. We were running out of money, we were running out of time. We wound up picking pears way over in Washington. For 8 months before that, we were hitching down the road with a dog named Elijah, 1 year old. Had that dog ever since he was a little pup. Now our baby was growing up. Walk out into Elijah, I just can't say. I guess she started reaching the curious age, and she had this aroma she was sending all over the land. And in every backyard for 4 or 5 miles, every male dog was howling and going wild. They were driving their owners crazy, but they didn't care. Dog love was in the air. Jumping out of windows, breaking off chains, poodles, cocker spaniels, German shepherds, great Danes, raunchy, rabid, ugly, mangy, mean. They were trying to find the orchard queen. I was in a tree and Elijah was right down beneath me, and to my surprise I saw 25 male dogs closing in on her. And so I picked me a pear and I threw it on down. I hit a cocker spaniel, I knocked him to the ground. He got up quick, he was dazed, but he wasn't deterred. And so I threw down another and I hit him on the head, and he went down hard. I thought he was dead, but he still went for Elijah after taking 2 direct hits. The little sucker was passionate. Jumped from the tree and we ran to the shack, pursued by a horny, crazed wild dog pack. And our dog Elijah fought us every inch of the way. And when we got to the shack, we were both in shock, and we felt like we were in a movie by Hitchcock. We looked at each other and we didn't know what to say. How could our little girl act this way? You know, you try to bring him up right, feed him out, Poe, you keep him tied at night, you try to teach him morals and teach him about society. And then one day they're a sweet, innocent child. The next day, you know, they're all running so wild. Elijah, I never thought you would turn out to be a picture of promiscuity. The next morning, I took a pair of my BVD underwear and I put them on Elijah and I put her tail through the little hole. Let's all try to picture that if we could. And I let her run free in the orchard that day, and every male dog in Washington State took a try at Elijah, but the only thing they felt was the low budget chastity belt. That night when we got to the shack, I took the underwear, I threw them out back. They were wet and they were dirty and I didn't think much of it. I didn't realize that they were the equivalent of the Holy Grail in the male dog population. Silly me, cause Lord Almighty, what happened then? When the male dogs got a good whiff of them, it was the biggest dog riot that there ever was anywhere. Over Elijah's underwear. They fought and rumbled, they brawled all night. They were killing one another till the morning light. They were fighting to the death for the greatest prize anywhere. When it all was finished, when it all was done, a Doberman pincher was the champion. He was wounded, but he looked so triumphant standing there with Elijah's underwear. He won him fair and square. They were torn to shreds, he didn't even care. He looked so proud standing there. That's a rough song. That's a rough song, but Tom Bianchi set the bar high. That song comes in underneath it. There you go.
Thank you, Don.
Welcome, Sarah. Thank you to everybody. I apologize for any fragile people out there. All right. So let's hear it again for Danielle and Tim. And Brandon, Brian Dozer, thank you. As I've said many times, if I click my button that says end meeting, it's very abrupt and it feels weird, like the screen just goes white. We're all sitting here talking and pretending we're together, and all of a sudden, back to being alone all by yourself. So I'm not gonna do it. It's hostile. I need you to disappear one at a time, gently, go gently into that dark night, ladies and gentlemen. But thank you for coming. Carrie, thank you. Sarah, much love. Barbara, thank you so much for helping get folks up to this. Good job. Tim will be talking. Tim Foley will be talking. Tim Mason will be talking. My friends from Nebraska, oh, much love. You know, there's another group I can't do without for sure. Kate, I know you're